So in this lecture, I'll be talking about different types of RC circuit. In the last two lectures, I've talked about RC low-pass filtering circuit involving a simple resistance and a capacitor. Now, today the construction of the circuit a little bit different. In fact, the position of the R and the C will be just opposite as compared to the last circuit as we did last time. Eventually, that particular circuit which we discussed last day was a low-pass one, and today the circuit that I'm dealing with is a high-pass network. And gradually, we'll understand why is it known as a high-pass network. So, just the position of the capacitor and the resistor has been changed, just like this. So. This is the capacitor. This is, we have resistance over here. We apply the input V in T between these two nodes, and we'll be getting output between these two nodes. Now, obviously, we will perform some mathematical analysis in identifying the behavior of the circuit. But before that, let us try to understand the property of the circuit intuitively. Now, this is a circuit consisting of a simple capacitor and a resistor. And if I apply an input signal over here, and let us assume that the corresponding frequency of the input signal is not constant. Suppose it is varying from a very low value, say from 0 hertz to a very high, like megahertz or even larger than that. Now, what happens to the output upon applying this particular input? As you know, the reactance provided by the capacitor is given by 1 upon SC. That means as the frequency operation increases, then the reactance provided by the capacitor will reduce. So we know that the reactance of any capacitor, which is very much dependent upon the signal frequency, that is equal to 1 by J omega C, or that is equal to 1 by J twice by FC. So as you know, if you increase F, then the reactance will reduce. That means when you select the value of F to be zero, perfectly DC signal, then it implies that the corresponding reactance is tending towards infinity. It's very large, irrespective of the value of the capacitor. So for a DC signal, if I just want to apply DC signal over here, then what happens? The reactance provided by the capacitor is very large, and we may think that this input side and output side is connected by means of capacitor, and that capacitor is being replaced by means of a reactance, and that reactance value is very large. And as a matter of fact, this input side and output side, they are not connected. On the other hand, if the frequency operation is very large, in which case the reactance can be considered to be very small, so then you think that these two terminals, they are connected together and the current will flow. So initially, when the frequency operation is very small, this capacitor will provide an infinite reactance to the input signal. And if the signal is DC one, that means this particular circuit will provide a very high attenuation to a DC signal, or it will stop flowing the DC signal from the input to the output. On the other hand, as you increase the frequency operation, the reactance by the capacitor will reduce monotonically, and as a matter of fact, the output signal that gets developed across these two nodes, across the resistance, that will also increase. That means if you increase the frequency, the output developed over here will also increase. So intuitively, we can say that this particular circuit does the operation of a high-pass network. But before that, first of all, we have to analyze the circuit mathematically as well as we did last time. There could have been two different analyses as far as the behavior of any circuit is concerned. One is the qualitative analysis and second one is the quantitative analysis. So qualitative, in terms of the qualitative analysis, we can say that the circuit is a high pass one. It will pass the high frequency components, or it will provide very small attenuation to the high frequency signal, and it will provide a large attenuation to the low frequency signal. Now, moreover, we would try to analyze the circuit from mathematical point of view. So if I assume that the current that is flowing is IT, then we can simply write down the equation, the KVL equation. In fact, the equation would be the same as we did last time. So we can write it is like V in T is equal to 1 by C integration IT dt plus V out T. So that is the description of the circuit in the natural time domain. And if I'd like to represent the circuit in the transform domain, then we need to write it in terms of the reactance in the transform domain. Then the capacitance is being implemented by 1 by Cs, and the resistance will be as it is, that is R. And then the input signal is given by V in S, and output signal is given by V out S. Then one can easily find out the expression for the gain, which is nothing but V out S upon V in S. So if I move into the Laplace domain, S domain, then this calculation would be much more easier. And then this expression, as you understand, here the capacitor is being represented by means of one reactant, that is 1 upon Cs, and the resistance is as it is, that is S, that is R. Then what about V out S upon V in S? So that is nothing but R upon R plus 1 by Cs. That is equal to SRC divided by 1 plus SRC. Or you can also represent this thing like 1 by 1 plus 1 by SRC. So that is the expression for AVS. So if I would like to find out the gain, so AV omega, just by putting S is equal to J omega, that is equal to 1 by 1 plus so here you have S is given by J omega. That means 1 by, I think it will be better if I just eliminate the modulus right now for the time being. Yeah. So 1 plus 1 by S is given by J omega. So J omega RC. So that is equal to 1 by 1 minus J by omega RC. Now you can easily compute the mod of AV omega. So mod of AV omega is given by 1 upon 1 plus 1 by omega RC whole square. So 1 by square root of 1 plus 1 by omega RC whole square. So let me go to the next slide to discuss further in this issue. So mod of AV omega is given by 1 divided by 1 plus 1 by omega RC whole square. Similarly, you can write it down in terms of the Hertz frequency, AVF. that is equal to 1 upon 1 plus 1 by twice pi FRC whole square. Now from this particular equation, what you can see is if F is increased, then obviously this 1 by twice pi FRC, this entire thing will reduce. If you increase F, then this term in the denominator, 1 by twice pi FRC, will reduce. And since it is in the denominator, so the entire expression mod AVF will increase. So mathematically, we can say that if we increase F, then this mod AVF will also increase. This particular thing will also increase. And if you put a value of F is equal to 0, for example, then obviously in the denominator, the corresponding expression is evaluated to infinity and the mod of F here is becoming 0. So therefore, at F is equal to 0, at F is equal to 0, we find this mod of AVF is equal to 0. And if the value of F is very large, so that this entire expression can be treated, I mean, this particular thing, 1 by twice pi FRC, that goes to 0 for a very high value, for a very large value of F, then mod of AVF is equal to 1. So now we can plot the variation of this AVF, mod AVF, with respect to the frequency. So this is the magnitude response or frequency response, F versus mod AVF. So when F is very small, like if F is 0, then the value is equal to 0. And for a very high value of F, it is equal to 1. So it's something like this. So assume that if the value of F is very large, so asymptotically it is approaching towards 1. For a very large value of F, it is approaching towards 1. Right? So this one is 1. So this nature is of a high pass one, high pass filter. And similarly, we have to identify a frequency at which the mod of AVF is 70.7% of the peak value. Now the peak value here is 1, which is obtained at a very high value of frequency when this 1 by twice pi FRC is evaluated to 0. Now let us consider that we have a frequency like F of 1, where we find this mod of AVF that is equal to 1 by root 2. This is also known as the half power point, and we have discussed why it is known as half power point. Because if you calculate the power, so this is evaluated in terms of the voltage gain. So the power gain, if you just calculate over here, so the corresponding voltage gain should be 1 upon root 2, so that the power gain is becoming half. So if the maximum power is 1, then this power is nothing but the half of that, so that's why it is known as a half power point. It is also known as a 3 dB point, because if you take this 20 log 10, then for a very high value of F, this 20 log 10 of mod AVF is evaluated to 0 dB, and at F1, this 20 log 10 mod of AVF is evaluated to minus 3 dB. So it is known as a half power point or 3 dB point, where this mod of AVF is equal to 1 upon root 2. So if I put this one, mod of AVF to be 1 upon root 2, so then as you understand, this entire thing is equal to 1. What I mean to say, 1 plus 1 by twice pi FRC whole square. This entire thing must be equal to 2. That means this one, 1 by twice pi FRC whole square, must be equal to 1, or that is 1 by twice pi FRC that is equal to 1. From that, and it happens at F1, so we can write like F1. So from that we can write F1 is given by 1 by twice pi RC. So in fact, you have got a similar expression in the last time also. The value was 1 by twice pi RC, but the nature is different. This time it's a kind of a high pass nature, and last time it was a kind of low pass behavior. Now this is known as the lower cutoff frequency, because anything less than this F1 is have a serious attenuation, is having a serious attenuation, and anything higher than this F1 will be passing through the circuit without much attenuation. So this is known as the lower cutoff frequency. So instead of making like F1, we can also say like FL. Right. So instead of making like F1, we can also say like FL. So this is a lower cutoff frequency. So there is no such higher cutoff frequency for a high pass filter. So if this value is equal to 0.707, if this value is 0.707, then this point is the lower cutoff frequency, that is FL. So anything higher than FL will be passed through the circuit, and anything lower than FL will be seriously attenuated by the circuit. So that's what is known as a high pass filter. So there is a low frequency, there's a lower cutoff frequency. Over and above, all the frequency components will be allowed to pass. So both qualitatively and as well as quantitatively, we can prove that this RC circuit, which we have started today, is a high pass one. It will allow the high frequency component to pass through, and it will stop the low frequency component. And obviously, there is a particular threshold over and above. We can say that the signal will be passed without much attenuation, and that is known as the FL, or the lower cutoff frequency. Now, with this basic understanding, let us try to analyze what about the output response of the circuit because of the application of different types of inputs. So, in fact, we will deal with the same inputs which we did last time, like unit step, or rather a step function, then a pulse waveform, then the square wave, and ultimately the ramp function. Now, to start with, we can consider a simple step function. So we'll apply a step function at the input to the circuit, and let us try to find out what is the behavior of the circuit. So V in T here between these two nodes, and V out T between these two nodes. So the governing equation will be the same, that is V in T is equal to 1 upon C integration I T dt plus, so if I assume that the current that is flowing through the circuit is I T plus R I T. So that is the governing equation. So we can start differentiating the circuit, differentiating this expression, like dv into dt is equal to it upon c plus r dit dt. Now here we are applying a step waveform like this. The input signal goes like this. This is your input. Suppose the peak value is V. It's a scaled unit step function with an amplitude of V. So therefore, for any value of time which is greater than zero, we can think that this dv into dt is evaluated to zero, because it's a constant waveform. So we can write like it by c plus r dit dt is equal to zero, and that can be written like 1 upon rc into it plus dit dt is equal to zero. So we can simplify the linear differential equation up to this point, and then we can apply the Laplace transformation so that this differential equation can be reduced to some algebraic form. Now, if I apply the Laplace transformation, so on applying Laplace transformation, what you find is you have 1 upon RC over here, and here you have IS. Plus, so dit dt, so as you know, the corresponding expression is SIS minus I0 plus. That is equated to 0. Now from that, we can connect IS with I0 plus. So IS into S plus 1 by RC. That is equal to I0 plus. So I0 plus is the current that is flowing through the circuit at t is equal to 0 plus. So what do you mean by t is equal to 0 plus? That means when the value of t is just greater than 0. It's equal to 0, but just greater than 0. Just to apply the input. So that is I0 plus. After you switch on the circuit, the current that is flowing through the circuit is known as I0 plus. Now, while calculating this I0 plus, you have to remember some basic property of a capacitor. The property says that the voltage across the capacitor cannot change instantaneously. Because you know that the voltage across the two plates of the capacitor integration I t dt. Now, if that value changes instantaneously, then obviously the current that is going to flow through the capacitor should be infinite. But that is not allowed in a practical circuit. So therefore, the voltage across the capacitor, across the two plates of the capacitor, cannot change instantaneously. So at t is equal to 0 plus, the left-hand side, if I assume that initially the capacitor is uncharged, that means there is no voltage drop between the two plates of the capacitor. Then at t is equal to 0 plus, when you apply this step function at the left plate of the capacitor, now, since the voltage across the capacitor cannot change instantaneously, so the right plate, this is also having the same voltage, that is V. Now, if this voltage is equal to V, then what about the current that is flowing through the circuit? So this voltage is equal to V, this is the ground terminal, so the current that is flowing is V upon R. So from that, we know that this I naught plus is given by assuming that the voltage across the capacitor cannot change instantaneously, so this I naught plus is given by V upon R, assuming that the capacitor is initially uncharged. There is no potential difference between the two plates of the capacitor. So I naught is given by V upon R. So from that, we can write IS is equal to V by R into S plus 1 by RC. So that is the expression for IS. And if you know IS, you can easily find out this V out S, because V out S is nothing but the voltage drop across the resistance. So V out S is given by R times I of S. So that is equal to V by S plus 1 by RC. So the output voltage in the Laplace domain is given by V upon S plus 1 by RC. So from that, you can easily write down if we apply the inverse Laplace transformation now, then V out T is given by V e to the power minus T by RC. V into e to the power minus T by RC. So that is the expression for the output voltage. So now if you plot this output voltage, or if you plot the output versus input, so this variation with respect to the time, so this is V in T, it's like that, it's constant, that is V. And parallelly, if I would like to draw the variation of V out, let me write down the expression for V out T here for the sake of convenience. That is given by V into e to the power minus T upon RC. So So as you find over here, so if I plot V out t, at t is equal to zero, the voltage is equal to V, and as t increases, the voltage this V out t drops exponentially, and for a very high value of t with respect to RC, ultimately this V out t is evaluated to zero. So then we can have a variation like this. So I think let me just there is something like that. It's not linear. So this variation is V into e to the power minus t upon RC. Once again, you can find out the time at which if you put t is equal to RC, if you put t is equal to RC, or at t is equal to RC, the V out t is just V into e to the power minus 1. That means equal to 0.368 V. So let us mark this point on this graph. Suppose this is the point. So this is the time. So if I mark this to be t is equal to RC, and here this value is equal to 0.368 of V. So there is a drop of 63.2% from the initial value. Okay. So now obviously, depending upon, as you understand, this behavior, this output signal will drop exponentially, but depending upon the relative value of this RC time constant with respect to the time, the corresponding variation will vary. So let us just try to understand this using three different values for this time constant. In one case, we will assume that this suppose this is the the initial level, that is V. Let us consider three different scenario. Let me use three different color for that. One is the one which we have shown just now. This one, where this is comparable, RC is comparable with respect to time. Second one is, so it's a comparable RC. That means with respect to time, it is comparable, comparable RC. It's not very large, not very small. Neither large nor small, comparable RC. Then you consider a scenario where the RC is very large. Now if RC is very large, then this e to the power minus t by RC. So if RC is very large, then this t by RC ratio would be very small with respect to time. Now if it is very small, then e to the power minus x. Now if the x value is very small, then this e to the power minus x could have been written like 1 minus x only, because the higher order terms can be neglected. The expression for e to the power x is given by 1 plus x square root factorial 2 plus x cube factorial 3 and so on. So if the argument x is small, then obviously these higher order terms x square, x cube, x to the power 4 can be neglected. Now that happens when this RC value is very large. Now if RC is very large, then this e to the power minus t by RC can be simply written like 1 minus t by RC. So then this exponential nature can be realized or can be obtained like a linear one. So I think it's a linear one, right? I think I can redraw this one once again. You can redraw it once again. something like that. Anyway, it's becoming difficult to draw on this platform. And let us consider the third case, when RC is very, very small. So it's a comparable RC. So comparable RC we have mentioned over here, the second one. And here, the first one, as you have understood, the first one stands for the value of RC is very, very large. So RC is very, very large. So that means this expression is this exponential nature can be written like a simple linear one. So large RC. And the third one, there's a small RC. Now, if RC is very small, then obviously it will follow the corresponding exponential nature. So here I have to mention, this one is large RC. This is the comparable one. And small RC. So mathematically, we can have three different graphs like this. But apart from that, you have to understand the basic principle why the value of, the output voltage comes down to zero very quickly for a pretty small RC. As you can find over here, if you just compare these three graphs, first, second, and third, you'll see that for a very large value of RC, the output voltage will take much time to reach towards zero. And if the value of RC is very small, if RC time constant, this product is very small, then the output voltage can come down to zero at a much faster rate. So what is the logic behind that? Qualitatively, we have to analyze this one. So once again, let us go back to the circuit. So we have this particular circuit to analyze. Now, if the RC time constant is very small, that means for the capacitor, so at the left-hand plate of the capacitor, you have this voltage, step voltage of amplitude V. Now, the objective of the capacitor to get charged to this value, but obviously it cannot do it instantaneously. It will take some time, and that time is evaluated in terms of RC time constant. Now, if the RC time constant is very small, that means the capacitor will take small time to get charged to the highest level, that is at V. So for a very small value of RC, the capacitor will take the circuit is very fast because RC time constant is small, so the circuit is fast. So the capacitor can charge to the peak value very quickly. So here you're applying a voltage of V at the input node. And for a very small value of RC, the capacitor can charge up to V very quickly. So what is left? The output voltage is nothing but the summation. The input voltage is nothing but the summation of the voltage across the capacitor plus this one, the voltage across the resistance. Or in other words, the output voltage can be written like the input voltage minus the voltage across the capacitor. Now, when the voltage across the capacitor is equal to the input voltage, that means when the capacitor can charge to V, then obviously the output voltage will become zero. Now that happens, so output voltage equal to zero only happens when the voltage across the capacitor is equal to V. That means when the capacitor can charge up to the peak value. Now for a very small value of RC, this happens very quickly. So the input voltage and the voltage across the capacitor, they are equal, so the output voltage becomes. However, for comparable RC, it will take a little bit more time than that. And for a large value of RC, the capacitor, since the RC time constant is large, so the capacitor will take much time charge up to this particular value of V, and therefore the output voltage will come down to zero after very high value of T. So that is the difference. So now we have completed the discussion on the response of the circuit because of a step function. Now let us try to understand what happens for a pulse waveform. So we will analyze the same circuit, but the input here is the pulse. In fact, for the pulse, if we know the response of the circuit because of a step function, we can readily obtain the output because of a pulse, assuming that the pulse is a combination of two different step, one a positive step and the negative step, but applied at two different time. So the same analysis which we did last time for RC low pass network. So V in T versus V out T. Now here the input is something like this. So the input is a pulse waveform which exists from 0 to T. So let me just draw the input versus output. So this is the input. V in T. Between 0 to T, and the voltage equal to V, and you are applying this. So what about the output of the circuit during this interval 0 to T? Assuming a comparable value of RC with respect to time, so we can have an exponential kind of behavior. So the output voltage, so V in T or V out T. So I'm going to draw the same graph. I mean, on a same graph, I would like to show the two different variations, input versus output. So here you find that it's an exponential decaying like this. And that is in accordance with V e to the power minus T by RC. So this exponential nature will be followed in this duration from 0 to T. So what happens at T is equal to capital T? Now at T is equal to capital T, once again you find that there is an abrupt change across the, I mean, there is an abrupt change at the input side. Because from 0 to T, you have a value of equal to V, and at T is equal to T plus, the value is becoming 0. That means the input voltage changes abruptly at T is equal to capital T. But the capacitor cannot just withheld that instantaneous change. That means the voltage across the capacitor cannot change instantaneously. That is the property of the capacitor. So at this particular time, if I call this voltage equal to, say, this voltage, let this be Vp, then this Vp can be represented like V e to the power minus T by RC. So that is the output voltage over here. Now, if there is a sudden change over here, so as you understand, this input voltage is being divided into two components. So we can write this V in T is having two different components. One is the Vc part, which is a function of time, which cannot change instantaneously. However, the voltage across the resistance can change instantaneously. And this voltage is nothing but the output voltage. So we can write Vct plus Vout, because the resistance, I mean, the output voltage is obtained across the resistance. Now, if there is a sudden change across, I mean, at the input node, if there is a sudden change, then the capacitor, this voltage cannot withstand that jack change. In fact, the voltage across the capacitor will remain as it is. It cannot change instantaneously. So therefore, a drop of V, because from V to zero, so at the input side, there is a sudden drop of amount equal to V. So that is reflected across this resistance. So the corresponding change in input voltage from V to zero, or in other words, the drop of amount of equal to V, is being reflected across the output nodes. So as a matter of fact, here there will be a drop, and that is equal to V. So the voltage across the resistance, which is nothing but the output voltage, is equal to V. And you can have this value. And then after that, what happens? Then if you consider the time t greater than capital T, I think this one is just, let me just erase that part. I have to just change the position. So this is capital T. And if I call this as V, so this is V. Now after T is equal to capital T, the input is equal to zero. The input is equal to zero because there is no explicit input being applied after T is equal to capital T. So once again, you can write down the expression, I mean KVL, and now the KVL expression is evaluated to 1 upon C integration IT dt plus RIT is equal to zero. That means you can write like minus 1 upon RC integration IT dt is equal to IT. Now if you differentiate then it will become minus 1 upon RC IT is equal to DIT DT. From that you can write like, from that what you can write is minus RC, minus RC integration DIT by IT is equal to integration DT. And you know, integration of DX upon X will give you ln X, and integration of DT will give you simply T. So if you just do this mathematical operation, ultimately you'll find that the expression for the current IT is coming like, obviously it's an, so expression for this one can be written like Vp minus V upon R into e to the power minus T by RC. So it's an indefinite integration. So integration over DIT by IT will give you ln IT. So I think I can complete the calculation over here. So after this point, we are over here. So minus RC, then you have ln IT, plus you can consider some constant because it's an indefinite integral, and that constant you can also write in terms of rather it will be better if I just change the sign, like सम्मेलन के दैट इज इक्वल टू माइनस टी. देन फ्रॉम दैट यू कैन राइट के आई टी इज इक्वल टू ई टू द पावर माइनस टी बाई आर सी. So it is equal to 1 upon k to the power minus t by rc. So that value of it you have to compute by using the boundary condition. That means at t is equal to 0, so you have to start from this point. At t is equal to 0, the corresponding value of the current is given by vp minus v upon r, because here the voltage across the resistance at t is equal to 0, I mean t is equal to capital T here, that is equal to vp minus v. And the current flowing is Vp minus V divided by R. So if you redefine the origin once again from this point, then you can write like e to the power minus T by RC as a different entity. But if you want to follow the same expression, I mean the same graph, then obviously e to the power minus T by RC will get modified by e to the power minus T minus capital T by RC. But in any case, the output voltage will follow an exponential nature, and ultimately it will move towards zero like this. So that you can write like, so if you redefine the origin at t is equal to capital T, then you can simply write e to the power minus t by rc. And if not, if you consider that the origin is here, I mean the same origin, if you follow for the two graphs, then it will be like vp minus v into e to the power minus t minus capital T by RC. If you don't want to redefine the origin, that means that t is equal to capital T, the output voltage is given by Vp minus V. And obviously this value is negative. Since Vp is less than V, so Vp minus V must be negative. So that should be the nature of the output for any pulse input, pulse type of input signal. Here also you can have two different types of, I mean rather three different types of variation. So here this entire analysis has been done with respect to a comparable RC. However, if you have a situation where the RC is much, much larger with respect to this pulse width, so I think it will be better if I draw three different graphs over here. So the same input you are applying. I'm writing in terms of V out T. Okay. V out T for three different cases. Comparable RC. So this is the input pattern. So the input pattern is this much. So last one should be the comparable RC, because already we have discussed this one. So this value is V, and this is okay. Let me just I think I have to change, because I don't find sufficient space for that. I don't find sufficient space to show the variation. Anyway, so now it's fine, it looks fine. So this one is capital T, this one is capital T, this one is capital T. Now if the coming back to our previous discussion, I mean, if the RC value is very small, then the output voltage can drop towards zero very quickly. The circuit is faster. So let me start with this one. It should come down to zero. So it will come down to zero at a very fast rate, and then at t is equal to capital T, if RC is very small, then the output voltage can come down to zero at a very faster rate, and at t is equal to capital T, the output voltage equal to zero. Then there is a sudden change in the input side. The drop is by an amount of capital V, so that has to be reflected in the output voltage, the voltage across the resistance, by means of another spike. And this value is, I mean, this is minus V also. And once again, it will come to a zero like this. So this is, I mean, this value is V. If I just mark this one. So this is V. And this happens for RC time constant much, much small as compared to T. So here you have the pulse width, that is capital T. So if the RC time constant is much, much smaller as compared to T, then this exponential form of output voltage will drop towards zero at a very faster rate. Then you consider the another extreme case when the RC value is much, much larger as compared to T. That means for the capacitor, it will take much time to charge up to the peak value of V. So in that case, since this T by RC can be considered very small because RC is much, much larger as compared to T, so then the exponential nature can be simplified to a simple linear form, and in which case you have a variation like this. So it's, if it's a linear one, or let it be even smaller. So linear one, RC value is much, much larger as compared to T. Obviously, it depends upon the exact value of T and RC. So, but this difference is once again V. This difference is once again V. And here the RC time constant is much, much larger as compared to the pulse width, that is capital T. So there is a linear variation. And the third one, which we have already discussed, a comparable one. So it will be something like that. And this difference, as you understand, this difference is also V. So it's a comparable, RC is comparable to T. Not equal, but comparable towards T. So depending upon the relative value of RC time constant with respect to the pulse width, so there could have been three different waveforms. So now, after discussing the behavior of the response to pulse input, let us now try to understand what happens for any square wave signal or rectangular wave signal. So in the last class already, we have talked about the rectangular wave. How does it look like? In fact, If I consider rectangular wave, it's a periodic one. So in general, this VT, for a rectangular wave, it looks something like that. In general, I'm talking about. So it is having two different levels. One is at V1, and the second one is at V2. So these are the two levels. See, in general, for a rectangular wave, it's a periodic one. So this one is V1, and this level is V2. And the corresponding time window for each of them are not same. So that's what is known as rectangular. So this one is T1, this one is T2. And the overall time period is capital T. So capital T, that is the time period of the rectangular wave, is given by T1 plus T2. It is having two different levels, V1 and V2. Now here, intentionally, I have selected V1 and V2 to be greater than zero. Sometimes the V2 could have been zero and V1 could be some non-zero entity, in which case you have some unipolar NRZ kind of waveform. Sometimes the V1 could have been positive, V2 could have been negative, in which case you have a bipolar kind of waveform. And sometimes the T1 and T2, these two time duration might be same, might not be same. Now, if T1 and T2, they are same, then these two fluctuations, I mean, if T1 and T2, they are same, then the width of this pulse and width of this pulse will be same. And then in that particular case, this graph is known as, this waveform is known as a square wave signal. But here, for the sake of simplicity or, you know, to make the discussion much more general, I have selected a rectangular waveform for analysis. So here, purposely, I am not assuming that these are T1 and T2, they are same. But if T1 and T2, they are same, in which case you have a square wave signal with a duty cycle of 50%. Now, if you provide this kind of waveform to the input of any RC high-pass network, what will be the corresponding output that you have to evaluate? But before that, you have to understand one important characteristics. Whenever you are going to apply any periodic waveform to an RC network like this. Now, first of all, let me just very quickly draw the circuit for your understanding. Now, since we have a periodic waveform, we can always represent this periodic waveform by means of a Fourier series representation. So V in T and V out T. So we can always represent any periodic signal by means of Fourier series representation, where you have some the DC component, zero frequency component, plus what you have is the other high frequency component. So you have a sinusoidal signal and the harmonics of that plus some DC component. So any periodic waveform can be represented in this particular form. So if I first of all, if I apply this KVL over here, you can write down the expression. So this V in T is equal to 1 by C integration over IT dt plus V out. So that is true for any input signal, whether it is periodic or aperiodic. But for the periodic signal, the main difference is that with respect to any other signal, is that it can be decomposed by means of Fourier series in terms of a DC component plus the sinusoidal component and its harmonics. So this V in T can be represented by means of the KVL in this particular form, where IT is the current that is flowing through the circuit. And as you understand, this IT is nothing but V out T by R. because the same current is flowing in a series path, and if it is flowing through a resistance R, the voltage developed is V out. So it is equal to V out T by R. So with this, we can write V in T is equal to, so it is equal to V out T by R. So 1 upon RC integration over V out T dt plus V out T. Now, if you differentiate the left hand side and the right hand side with respect to time, then it is equal to dv in t dt is equal to 1 upon RC V out T plus dv out T dt. And from that, if you multiply with dt, and once again if you integrate, then ultimately it is like dv in t integration over dv in t 1 upon RC integration over V out T dt plus integration over dv out t. And suppose this integration, now we are invoking the concept of any periodic signal, and suppose this integration is being carried out over a single period of the periodic signal. So this is from 0 to capital T. So now let us make the limit from 0 to capital T. So ultimately what we find is this equation is valid. In fact, the first equation is valid for any input signal and for any output signal if I apply simple KVL over here. And then let us assume that we are applying one periodic waveform, and then with some after some mathematical calculation, this entire thing gets evaluated like this. So if I go to the next slide, I think it will be better. So what we find is integration, let me once again write it down, 0 to t dv in t is equal to 1 upon RC integration 0 to t v out t dt plus integration 0 to t dv out t. So this integration will give you, the result will give you v in t minus v in 0 is equal to 1 upon RC integration 0 to capital T v out t dt plus v out t minus v out 0. So now if you apply any periodic input signal, then under steady state condition, then obviously for any periodic waveform, if I consider a periodic waveform, a periodic signal, the input signal value at t is equal to 0 and t is equal to capital T, where capital T is the period of the input, must be the same. That means V in t is equal to V in 0. And obviously, you must understand from your basic intuition that under steady state condition, the corresponding output developed at t is equal to 0 and t is equal to capital T is also same. That means V out t is also equal to V out 0 for any periodic waveform. That means these two quantity, this left hand side V in t minus V in 0 and this right hand side V out t minus V out 0, both of them are equated to zero. And ultimately, we are left with 1 upon RC, integration over 0 to t, v out t dt is equal to 0. That means integration 0 to capital T, v out t dt is equal to 0. So what is the physical significance of this? That means if I apply for any RC network like this, RC high pass network like this, if I apply any periodic input signal, and then if you evaluate the area under the output over a single period, that area must be equal to 0. Now, if you apply some input which is having some positive quantity only, like this, this input is having the positive quantity. Each of these two levels are greater than 0. Both V1 and V2, they are greater than 0. Now, if you apply this input even towards this particular type of circuit, and if you observe the output waveform, then you'll see that the output waveform, if you integrate the output waveform over a single period, then you'll see that that integration will give you a value equal to 0. That means the area, the positive area and the negative area over a single period must be equal to 0. Now that particular thing only happens for a periodic waveform. Now what is the, so that is the one observation from this particular mathematical description. But what about the other important feature associated with this particular expression? Whenever you calculate an expression like this, 0 to t, v out t dt, mathematically for any waveform, as you understand that if v in t is a periodic waveform, the v out t must also be periodic. There is no doubt about that. If v in t is a periodic waveform, then v out t must also be periodic for this kind of RC network. Now, what is the physical significance of having this integration 0 to capital T v out t dt? It evaluates the area under the curve, that is fine, that you understand from your basic knowledge in mathematics. But what is the physical significance as far as the context of signals and systems is concerned? So if you integrate any periodic waveform over a single period, it will give you the average value. For example, if you integrate a sinusoidal signal, say A sine omega t, over a single period, then obviously that value is equal to 0. A sine omega t dt, integration over 0 to capital T, will be equal to 0. Because for a sinusoidal signal, let me just show you. Say, let us consider a sinusoidal signal like this. It's a periodic one. Now, if you integrate over a single period, A sine, so this one is A sine or A cos omega t, A sine omega t, this expression, this one. So if you integrate this zero over a single period, 0 to t, A sine omega t dt, that will equal to 0. So what is the physical significance? What is the physical parameter that you're extracting by means of this integration? This is nothing but the average level or DC level of the signal. So instead of having A sine omega t, if the value is like A sine omega t plus some constant like B, and then if you integrate, then the result will be B. Now, if you consider this is the input signal, and if you apply over here, then the result will be 0. I mean, if V out t is given by this, then the result will be 0. On the other hand, if the signal looks something like that, that means it is riding on a DC level, right? Then if you integrate it over a single period, then the integration result will be nothing but the DC value, this value, this DC value. That means in one word, we can say that integration over 0 to t, any signal, Vt dt, will deliver the corresponding DC level associated with the circuit. Now, when you apply a periodic waveform to a RC network like this, we find that the DC level is becoming 0. Why? Because already we have proved that this particular network is of a high pass network. That means it will only allow the high frequency components, and it will stop the low frequency component to pass through it. And a frequency value equal to 0 hertz is known as the minimum frequency that is available. That means it will provide infinite attenuation to a DC signal. As we have seen earlier, this particular network, RC network, will provide infinite attenuation to a DC signal. So therefore, once again, if you compute the, or if you analyze the output signal, input signal is a periodic one, and the periodic signal is having two different components. One is a DC component plus some high frequency components, a sinusoidal signal and its harmonics. Now, depending upon the cutoff frequency, depending upon the lower cutoff frequency, some of the harmonics will be passed and some of the harmonics will be attenuated by the circuit. So that cannot be known until and unless you know the exact value of signal frequency and you know the lower cutoff frequency of the circuit, until and unless you know the R and C value. But one thing is very sure, that whenever you have a circuit, whenever you have a waveform like this, it is having a DC component, and that DC component experiences very high attenuation, ideally infinite attenuation from the circuit. So therefore, if you just observe the output waveform, the corresponding DC component is equal to zero. So that can be validated from two different perspectives. One, mathematically, as we have seen, integration of 0 to t, V out t equal to 0. That means the output signal, if you integrate it over a single period, the positive area and the negative area, they must get cancelled with each other. And qualitatively, it suggests that the DC component of the output waveform must be equal to 0. So now, with this understanding, let us now apply. A periodic waveform. For example, we may apply square wave signal or rectangular wave signal, and let us see how about the performance of the circuit. In fact, this rectangular waveform can be viewed as a repetition of the pulse waveforms, the positive pulse and the negative pulse. So let it be V in T. Let us assume a situation like this. Let me consider are two different levels. Let us assume that the V2 level is equal to 0. And this is equal to V. This duration is T1. This duration is T1. Let me mark over here. So this one is T1. And this point is T1 plus T2. And if I apply this input over here, let us try to observe the output. So let us initially assume that the RC time constant is comparable with both T1 and T2. Then it will follow a nature like this. This one. Then you have this much. And then once again, at t is equal to T1 plus T2, there is another positive pulse being applied, unlike the simple pulse. For simple pulse, you have seen that beyond T1, no signal was applied. So that means ultimately this waveform beyond T1 approaches towards zero value. But here, the situation is different because once again at T is equal to T1 plus T2, another positive pulse of amplitude V is being applied. Suppose this one. Then now I think it will be even less because initially assuming that the output voltage the voltage across the capacitor, it was initially zero, so therefore the output voltage abruptly is equal to V whenever you just switch on the circuit at T is equal to zero plus. So therefore V out is equal to V. But then once again at this particular point, this voltage was not equal to zero, rather some negative voltage because of this one. So automatically this will not be equal to V, less than V. But under steady state condition, this value will be maintained. You have to assume that, or you have to maintain that this fluctuation must be the same. I mean, from this point to this point, this fluctuation must be the same. Anyway. And now it will be followed. So this difference is V. This difference is V. And this difference is also V. So there is an increase by an amount of V at T is equal to T1 plus T2. And there is a decrease by an amount of V at T is equal to T1. And that is all because of the corresponding variation of the input waveform. Because the voltage across the capacitor cannot change instantaneously. So any change that occurs at the input side will be reflected across the voltage across the resistance, that means the output voltage. Now once again, depending upon, since we have not selected T1 to be T2, so these two values are different, so it's not a perfectly square wave, but rather rectangular wave. Now already we have seen that for this output voltage, integration over V out T dt, V out T dt over a single period from 0 to capital T must be equal to 0. That means this component, this one, and this area, so this positive and negative area must be equal and opposite. So I have drawn manually, so that might not be same or that might not be equal. It seems like that, but as far as the mathematical derivation is concerned, since the DC level must be equal to zero, so if you just integrate, if you have a waveform like this, then the positive area must be equal to the negative area. Now, if once again you can have a different scenario, so here I have assumed that the RC value is comparable to T1 and T2. Now, there could have been situation where RC is much, much larger as compared to T, and there could have been also some situations where RC is much, much smaller with respect to T. Accordingly, you can have a different such scenario. For example, if I consider this one, I think it will be better if I use a different description. Let me go to the next slide. And let us have a different description, like say the input signal is both positive and negative. So let us assume that this is the input signal whose two levels one level is greater than zero, the other level is less than zero, like this. So now if you just consider, so this is the input signal, input pattern. Let me write over here V in T. And if this value is equal to, say, let me mark it over here. And these are the two levels, V1, and this is V2. And this difference is V, for example. This difference is V. So the output pattern will be something like that. Let us assume some comparable RC. Then the same drop. So this entire thing is for comparable RC. With respect to T1 and T2. Now, similarly, you can have a situation where the RC time constant is much, much small as compared to the time period of this periodic waveform. In which case, I'm just drawing the corresponding output waveform because the input will be the same. So this is time, this is the V out T. Accordingly, if the time constant is very small with respect to the time period of the input waveform, then you can have a situation like this. Once again, at T is equal to T1 plus T2, you have another positive spike and followed by negative spike. So that difference is V. And this is also V. Now this happens when RC time constant is much, much smaller as compared to T. T is the total time duration, that is T1 plus T2. So this is T1. This distance is T1. And this distance is T2. And T is equal to T1 plus T2. So when the RC time constant is much, much smaller as compared to this T, then the capacitor can charge at a very faster rate, and accordingly the output voltage will look something like that. So you will be having some spikes, a positive spike when the input makes a transition by an amount of plus V, and a negative spike when the input makes a transition by an amount of minus V. And on the other hand, here also you can say that you can readily verify that this area, this positive area, under the curve and this negative area, these two must be equal and opposite. These two are equal and opposite. So over a single period, you will find that this integration over v out t dt zero to capital T must be equal to zero. And that happens irrespective of the DC level of the input signal. Whether the DC level of the input signal is positive or not, it doesn't matter. If you just calculate this one, integration over 0 to t v out t dt, that will give you the DC level of the output waveform. For example, as I was talking about, suppose the signal, any signal xt, which is equal to say a sine omega t like this. And if you perform this operation 0 to t xt dt, that is equal to 0. On the other hand, if the signal is, let me call the signal to be yt, that is equal to a sine omega t plus some constant, say b. And if you integrate integration of 0 to t yt dt, that is not equal to 0, rather that is equal to b. So depending upon the input DC level, this integration of 0 to t xt dt gets modified for any waveform. But here, because of the property of the circuit, because since it's a high pass filter, high pass network, because of the property of the circuit, we have evaluated that irrespective of the input level, irrespective of the input DC level, this integration of 0 to t v out to dt is always 0, whether the DC level is 0, DC level of the input signal is 0 or not. For example, if I consider this waveform, the input level of the if I consider the average level of this input signal, the DC level of this input signal is non-zero, because both of these two levels are greater than zero. So you know how to calculate the average level. It's nothing but you have to calculate the area over a single period. So it is nothing but V1 T1 plus V2 T2 divided by T1 plus T2. So since both V1, V2, T1, T2, both of them are positive, so therefore the average level, a DC level, must be greater than 0. V1 T1 plus V2 T2 by T1 plus T2, it should be greater than 0. On the other hand, if you come to this waveform, this one, we have two different levels, V1 and V2. One is positive, other one is negative. So here also the average level, if I just write it down, the V in average, that is equal to V1 T1 plus V2 T2 upon T1 plus T2. Where, as you understand, this one is T1 and this one is T1 plus T2. So V1 T1 plus V2 T2 divided by T1 plus T2. But as you see here, V1 is greater than 0 positive, but V2 is less than 0, that is negative. So until and unless we know the exact value for T1 and T2, we cannot say whether the average value is greater than 0 or less than 0 or equal to 0. So depending upon the relative value of V1, T1 and V2, T2, the average value could have been either greater than 0 or equal to 0 or less than 0. So we cannot surely say whether it is always greater than 0 or not. Right. But here also, even if we have some certain uncertainty regarding the DC level, here also, if you just consider the output waveform resulting from this input, the output waveform must satisfy this condition. Integration 0 to t, v out to dt is equal to 0. Because that is coming from the property of this high pass network. Integration over 0 to t, v out to dt is equal to 0. Because it will block the low frequency component. So irrespective of the DC level, whether it is 0 or not, the low frequency component will be completely blocked by the circuit. Okay. We have only one signal is left to analyze, and that is the ramp function. So for the ramp function, So as you know, we can have a signal like this, where the V in T is given by alpha T for T greater than equal to 0 and 0 for and 0 otherwise. So it is a ramp function. Now for the ramp function, we can calculate the response due to the ramp function. We'll follow the same analysis, but we have to do it in the Laplace domain. So in the Laplace domain, we know. So in the Laplace domain, this V out S. So we have V in T here, V out T here for this network. So in the Laplace domain, V out S can be written as V in S multiplied with R upon R plus 1 by SC. So that is equal to V in S SRC by 1 plus SRC. Now, since the input signal is a ramp function, so we cannot apply the previous calculation because it was for the step and the pulse and the square wave. So we have to analyze it from a different perspective. V in S for any ramp function is given by alpha by S square. So from that we can write V out S is given by alpha by S square, that is V in S multiplied with SRC divided by 1 plus SRC. So that is equal to, so one S gets cancelled. So you have alpha RC 1 by S into 1 plus SRC. So you have alpha RC into this much. Okay, fine. So what you need to do is that you have to represent this entire thing in terms of partial fraction expression. So let me just write it down like this. So if I take this RC common outside, so then it becomes alpha into 1 upon S into S plus 1 by RC. That is V out S. So then V out S is equal to alpha into 1 upon S to S plus 1 upon RC. So that you can write like 1 upon S minus 1 upon S plus 1 by RC. So that is easy to calculate. So S plus 1 upon RC minus S, so 1 upon RC. So we have to multiply it with RC, so alpha RC into this one. So V out S is given by alpha RC into 1 upon S minus 1 upon S plus 1 by RC. And that is a convenient form to deal with. And from that, if I apply the inverse Laplace transformation, L inverse, Laplace inverse, then it says that V out T is given by, so alpha RC is a constant term, 1 upon S minus 1 upon S plus 1 by RC. So the first term will be equal to 1, and this term is e to the power minus T by RC. So alpha RC into 1 minus e to the power minus T by RC. So depending upon the value of or the relation between this time constant and the corresponding time, there is certain observation. So if I just want to draw the input versus output, how does it look like? So here also you'll see that before going into the pictorial description, you have this term e to the power minus t by rc. Now let us consider a situation where rc is much much smaller. Let us consider a case where rc is much much smaller with respect to the time. Now if rc is much much small with respect to time, with respect to t, and then this e to the power, let us assume rc is very small, or small rc. Small rc. So small rc that means e to the power minus t by rc, that particular thing is equal to zero, because t by rc, that ratio is very large, then e to the power minus something large is approximately towards zero. And under which case we can write, if the rc value is very small with respect to the time, then this v out t is ultimately, or it's approximated towards alpha rc. That means if I would like to draw, let me write like simply vt. So that is the alpha t or v in t is equal to alpha t. Now the output voltage is given by alpha rc into 1 minus e to the power minus t by rc. So output cannot follow the input properly because you have some other quantity, and when the rc value is very small with respect to time, then this v out t gets saturated to simply alpha rc. So then this can be so if you have some tools to draw the waveform, then it is fine. Otherwise we can roughly show it like this. So when the t value is large with respect to rc, then the output voltage gets saturated over here. So this value is equal to alpha rc, and this is your v out t. So obviously there is certain deviation with respect to the input. So the input increases, it's a monotonical function, it increases with time. However, the output gets saturated after a certain time period, after a certain time, when the value of t is much much larger with respect to rc, or rc is much much smaller with respect to t, then it gets saturated almost. So that is for small rc. Now what happens for large rc? Now if rc is large, so let me once again write down the expression for the ramp function. So v out t is equal to alpha rc into 1 minus e to the power minus t by rc. Now if rc is very small, we can just neglect this this term, this quantity, e to the power minus t by rc. Now if the rc is very large, now if the rc is very large, then this t by rc would be small, then this e to the power minus t by rc can be approximated to 1 minus t by rc, because e to the power x can be approximated to 1 minus x, e to the power minus x can be approximated to 1 minus x if x is very small. So if rc is large with respect to time, then this 1 minus t by e to the power minus t by rc can be approximated towards 1 minus t by rc. And under this condition, we can write like v out t is equal to alpha rc 1 minus t by rc. Now it's 1 minus t by rc, so You can just neglect the higher order terms. So alpha 1 minus e to the minus t by rc will become simply t by rc into t by rc. And then this v out t can be approximated to alpha t. That means v out t is equal to v in t when we select that rc value is much, much larger with respect to the time. Now sometimes you can also include the terms up to the second order. That means sometimes you can also consider z to the power minus t by rc can be approximated to 1 minus t by rc plus the second component. In fact, you have the second component like t square by r square c square by factorial 2. So if you include that component, then obviously there is certain distortion. Otherwise, if you just use up to the first order, that means only the power of 1, then this e to the power minus t by rc can be approximated towards 1 minus t by rc, and 1 minus this one can be approximated towards t by rc, and then ultimately v out t is equal to v in t. But if you select that, okay, like if you select that e to the power minus t by rc is equal to the up to the second order, that means t by rc plus t square by 2 r square c square, then obviously there is certain distortion. Then this v out t can be written like alpha r c into t by r c minus t square by 2 r square c square. And then you have alpha t minus alpha t square by 2 rc. Then obviously you find that there is certain nonlinear behavior. So the input goes like this. V in t is equal to alpha t. And there is certain deviation from the input. If you select or if you include the second order terms up to the t square, then this alpha t minus alpha t square by 2 rc. So obviously there is certain distortion, certain deviation from the input. And that can be in the form of some square law variation. However, it will not happen for a very small value of t, because already I've selected the rc to be very large. And if the value of t is very small, then this t by rc is very, very small, so that can be approximated to alpha t. For small value of t, it is equal to alpha t, because this t square can be neglected with respect to rc. When the time is very small, then this part can be neglected. So that can be neglected. So this part can be neglected for small t, because you have t square term over here. Then your v out t is equal to alpha t, it will follow the input. But however, as the time increases, then you cannot, to some extent, you cannot neglect this t square term with respect to this one. Then obviously, this part you have to take into account, and accordingly, the v out t is a little bit less as compared to the input signal, that is alpha t. So that is the response of the circuit because of the application of a ramp input signal. So with this, we would like to conclude this discussion on RC high-pass filter and its response because of the application of different inputs like step function, pulse waveform, square wave signal, rectangle wave signal, and ultimately the ramp function.